Tudor Ranger is a watch I've always been fascinated with. It has an interesting history, and while it isn't as storied as other watches underneath the Rolex house, it brings a cool factor some of those other watches don't have. It may not be sold at boutiques and ADs anymore, but it is a watch worth a look, especially given their great value on the secondary market. Let's see what makes the Ranger so good. The modern Ranger lived a short life. It was only in Tudor's catalog for a couple of years before being quietly put on the shelf in mid-2020. The Ranger isn't a big watch by any means, but it almost seemed doomed from the start. Introduced at a time when modern reissues weren't as popular as they are now, and with much larger dimensions than the original, it's not surprising to see why it was passed over by so many. Despite how the dimensions look on paper, which really aren't that large in comparison to most other watches in this category, the Ranger wears so well. Its moderate lug-to-lug and relatively thin case mitigate the fact that the Ranger is almost all dial. It has wrist presence, but doesn't command attention. Add to that the variety of straps that this watch looks good with, which is basically any strap, and you have a watch that has looks and on-wrist comfort that many brands strive for today. It is all of these things that make it so odd as to why the Ranger was neglected by so many. Perhaps the introduction of the Black Bay by Tudor put the Ranger in the attic with Fuller in the Tudor household. The Ranger was the last modern Tudor to be offered with the Rose logo at 12 o'clock. To me, this is Tudor's coolest logo, and beats their Shield logo by a mile. But that's not all on the dial that makes the Ranger unique. The lume application on the Ranger is great, the broad arrow hand offers no confusion as to what hand you're looking at in the dark, and the numerals at the cardinal positions allow for easy orientation. This isn't the first watch to offer this setup, but it is executed well and still gives a bit of vintage flair. At first glance, the numerals and markers look printed flat. However, when you get close and you see they are heavily painted on, giving an effect similar to that of an applied marker. I've heard these are hand-painted, but I was not able to find any proof of that. Regardless, it's a cool effect, and when the light hits the dial just right, the numerals and markers really pop off from the matte black dial. So why did Tudor discontinue the Ranger? I've spoken to quite a few people about their thoughts on the Ranger, and I was usually met with an answer indicating that they would buy one if it were a bit smaller. While I wouldn't turn down the idea of a 38-39mm Tudor Ranger, I feel that answer is a disservice to this watch. The Ranger was ahead of its time, bringing a vintage-inspired look to the modern sport watch segment, and perhaps it got off to a slow start and could never catch up. I feel that most people clamoring for a smaller Ranger would be thrilled with the watch if they had just tried it on. I know I didn't see how great it was until I tried it on for myself. There isn't a thing about this watch that bothers me, which is rare. Even the straight end link bracelet works on this watch. I can't see a curved end link bracelet bringing more charm to the Ranger. Everything from the semicircle text that reads self-winding to the pop of color with the red seconds hand looks just right. The Tudor Ranger left us too early. I'm doubtful Tudor is cooking up a new version with different dimensions and an in-house movement. Hopefully, we'll see it again. Thanks for checking out the video review, and for the full written review, head over to watchclicker.com.